Okay. So the last several decades has seen incredible advances in the management of cancers. This graph is based on English data, and it shows the improvements in 10-year survival in a whole range of the common cancers. Whereas the old yardstick for survival used to be 5-year survival, that was the sort of classic yardsticks for survival. People now are looking at 10-year survivals, and there have been enormous differences or improvements in 10-year survival in all the major cancer groups over the last several decades. And of course, some of them are a little bit stuck, but we don't need to talk about pancreas adenocarcinoma. That's really stuck at the bottom. But I think this has led to really a big difference in the societal perception of what a diagnosis of cancer means. And there are now more and more people who are actually living with a diagnosis of cancer. And I think society has changed from thinking of people as being victims of cancer, which would have been the sort of general attitude in the 20s through perhaps to the 50s, now to looking at people who have actually survived cancer or surviving with cancer, perhaps. So if we look at a graph from the States of the projected number of cancer survivors. So at the moment in the US, it's reckoned that there are about 12 million people who are living with cancer. And this is obviously projected to increase. It looks like they're going to be voting Republican according to the color scheme here. It's hard to get away from it, but they're going to have to think about that anyway. This is a huge number of people. I mean, by 2030, we're going to be up to sort of 20 million people, a huge number of people who actually have to live with the consequences of having had cancer day to day. Now, you know, survivorship is an issue that, of course, affects people with every disease, but it seems to have particularly stuck with the diagnosis of cancer. I think there are a few other diseases where people have such strong fears and anxieties about dying. There are many diseases that have equally high death risks or mortality risks, but it seems to be particularly focused around the area of cancer. Many treatments are complex and multifaceted and proceed for many, many years. And, you know, many patients are cured from cancer. Increasingly, more are regarded as being having a chronic disease, and of course, as Donal mentioned, there are many who don't survive. There are different definitions people use for the term survivor. Living with a history of cancer seems to be fairly widely accepted. The National Cancer Institute in the States describes it as being someone who's had a malignant tumor and remains alive. But there's a lot of debate about how you define a survivor. And it's not everybody's favorite term. A lot of people feel a little uncomfortable with it. The actual meaning of the word has shifted over the decades, and all of the things we understand by the term survivor incorporate elements of the different understanding of the word as it's evolved. You know, in a legal sense, in terms of transferring title or transferring deeds, the term survivor has been around since the 1600s, so it's very deeply embedded. I think in the late 19th century, it was perhaps most recognizable in Darwin's sense of the survival of the fittest. In the 1940s, during the war years, it was particularly associated with people who had endured terrible and prolonged trauma, and most especially Holocaust survivors and people who'd been through prisoner of war camp experiences. Perhaps as a sort of knock-on effect from that during the 60s with the evolution of clinical psychology, many of the negative psychological effects of those traumatic experiences became highlighted. You know, in the 70s, as we began to see the evolution of the individual, it acquired a sort of slightly more colorful aspect, and we began to think of it as someone who's got a knack or a special ability to survive. And of course, like everything else in our modern age, has been blighted with the plague of celebrity culture, and perhaps it's been trivialized in current times. If you ask a teenager what they think of Survivor now, they think of Beyonce, and they think of the American TV series. So when we say survivor, it has little bits of all these things, so it's hard to escape them. As a topic in the sort of cancer field, it's not actually, it probably was most, was initially formalized back in the mid-80s. It wasn't really used before then in the sort of cancer field. And the time when it really came up first, I think, was following a publication by a young physician in the States who went through a fairly gruesome series of cancer treatments and eventually survived. But he wrote a long, very personal article in the New England Journal of Medicine. And he basically described his own personal experience. So although he was a physician, he was writing as a patient. He happened to have access to medical journals because of his physician training. So this chap, Fitzhugh Mullen, 1985, really argued against the old sort of binary view that if you had a cancer, you were either cured or you were not cured, and it was one way or the other. And he felt that this previous concept really divided people into these two different pathways. From his own experiences, he thought it was more appropriate to describe just one pathway that could be summed up in the term survival, and it was dominated by the physical and psychological effects of dealing with the diagnosis and treatment of cancer. And among other things, he went on to found one of the first organizations that tried to provide a framework for cancer survivors. Now, you know, most physicians, and Dermot and Donal will forgive me for this, are a bit like botanists. They like to sort of classify things and subclassify them. And Mullen was able to do this. Now, again, I would stress he did this as a patient. But he did describe three different phases which he felt he had gone through. And he felt that they had a lot of lessons for most people who go through the cancer experience. It can be a little clunky to try to divide these things into set phases, but I think there are elements that everybody will recognize as they go through the different phases that they experience following the diagnosis and treatment of cancer. And I don't have to sort of go through all of these individually. You know more about this than I do, actually, and will recognize many of these problems. You will have encountered many of them yourselves. There's no doubt, you know, taking on the label of a survivor does have very many positive effects. We all integrate our past experience into our current identity. And there's no doubt a diagnosis of cancer is a very, very powerful imprint on one's identity. I think it does allow people to be more active in dealing with the diagnosis and in dealing with the aftermath. You know, there's a whole industry in positive thinking. I chose the picture of Lance Armstrong carefully. You know, I mean, his legacy has definitely been blighted, but you have to. He's perhaps one of the arch examples of, you know, taking the fight to cancer. And I think there's been enormous benefit from that in terms of his ability to fundraise and so on and to institute change. But when you look at sort of some of the things he said, you know, cancer was the best thing that ever happened to me. It really does make you realize he must have been on drugs at the time when he was saying this. And of course, time has proven this correct. You know, there is an industry surrounding this business of positive thinking. You know, people like Lance Armstrong do personify that, and although they mean well, I think it is probably something that many people find very difficult to identify with. This lady, Barbara Ehrenreich, is an American, I suppose, social activist, social commentator, and she went through a breast cancer experience. And you can sort of see that she really nicely describes the counterpoint to that positive thinking sort of approach. When she sort of says that there's a whole mythology that people bravely battle their cancer and then they become survivors. And she makes the point that those who don't survive may be just as brave, just as courageous, and just as wonderful. I did say that it's not everybody's favorite term, and even Mullen, who wrote that article back in the 1980s, said that he wasn't entirely happy with it. It can alienate people who have progressive disease, and I think, you know, within this group, we've all had good friends and patients who have progressed and died. And it's hard to be described as a survivor when you feel like you're dying. So I think within the group, you know, within the term, people have tried to look for other words or other terms that may be more appropriate. And people have used things like aliver and thriver or dire to describe the different states of mind that people get into at different times in their disease. Just as an oddity, the concept of the previver has also been thrown up. I think this is a little bit of a step beyond. This is the patient who has does not have cancer, but may have risk factors, either genetic or familial. And it's a sort of mark of modern life that we're able that people are then loaded with a whole lot of anxiety issues that they must deal with. One of the other problems about the survivorship or survivor label is that it often doesn't focus on quality of life. I think survivorship is very cancer specific, and I think for this group, there are clearly a hugely diverse range of issues. There are many patients with neuroendocrine tumors who are cured. Equally, there are many patients who have aggressive and progressive disease who don't survive. And in between, there are many, many patients who have disease that requires chronic treatment. So I think the NET group in particular are exposed to the full range of survivorship experiences, whatever they may be. This issue of having to deal with detectable and progressive tumor means that it's very hard to move on to the sort of final stage of that survivorship process when you feel like you're a permanent survivor. And the indolent behavior creates that sort of difficult tension. Now, it's interesting that a lot of other tumor groups are beginning to understand the NET experience of living with cancer as a chronic disease. So many patients with colon cancer now really are treated as if they have a chronic disease. And I think the NET group knows a lot that could transfer to these other patient groups. I'm not going to tell you about the physical and the psychosocial and the economic effects that impact on survivorship. You know all about them. I mean, I think I would say the medical service tends to focus on the physical effects and really doesn't pay much attention or does not pay as much attention as it could or should to the psychosocial effects and almost no attention to the economic effects. You know, survivorship is not a treatment for the disease. The outcome depends on the interaction between the individual, the particular tumor with its own biological personality and the different treatments. Survivorship is not really, I guess what I'm trying to say is that how you survive doesn't affect the outcome of the disease. I mean, there has been a whole industry in terms of trying to support positive thinking as a way of dealing with disease. It doesn't affect the outcome. It affects how you live. But I think the idea that it has an impact on the behavior of the disease has been well and truly debunked. So what is survivorship? Well, I think it provides a framework for dealing with the diagnosis of cancer. I think it's a bit cheeky of a doctor to be talking to a patient group about it. I think this belongs to the patient particularly, and it belongs to the patient's family, and it belongs to the patient group, and it's incredibly individual. I think the different behaviors of NET tumors pose very particular problems that you're very aware of. Now, I always wanted to finish a talk with this quote from Nietzsche. It's the end of Terminator 2. I'm sure you'll all remember it. That which does not kill us makes us stronger. But I should have been an orthopedic surgeon if I was going to end a talk with that. So I'm not actually going to end with that talk because that quote, because, you know, for most of you, you will understand that it's garbage. It doesn't apply to survivorship after a diagnosis of cancer. Perhaps a little closer to the truth is Rose Kennedy's quote. She was, of course, referring to the loss of her sons. But I think it has a resonance for much of what you experience when you go through a diagnosis and treatment of cancer, and particularly with a prolonged course, as with the neuroendocrine tumors. Perhaps for some of us, the line is going to be between these two kind of attitudes. Maybe there is something in what the Terminator was saying about getting a little stronger as you integrate the effects of going through a cancer journey. But perhaps for most, you still have to live with the wounds, and time does scar them over, but they never go away completely. So on that unhappy note, I'm going to finish, and I'm conscious of the fact that I know very little about this, and I think as a group, you know far more than I do. So if I've been a little naive, I apologize, but it was really my reflection on this topic, which I think is particularly relevant for the NET group. Thank you.